It is a bittersweet opportunity to host an event marking the one-year anniversary of the large and inspiring pro-democracy demonstrations in Pearl Roundabout, which the Bahraini government then brutally suppressed. Evidently afraid of its own citizens, the country's rulers used deadly force against peaceful demonstrators. Let me, if you haven't already seen it, let me commend to you a documentary that was done by a Al Jazeera English film crew called Shouting in the Dark. Now, those of you in the room are very familiar with the grim tally of the crackdown. Dozens killed. We're referring here to the events of February of last year. Dozens killed, many more wounded, hundreds arrested, many of whom were tortured. Thousands lost their jobs. Doctors and nurses who had attended the wounded were charged as criminals. A dark chapter indeed in Bahrain's recent history, and as we know from events even of the last day or so, that chapter is not over. Since last February, the protests and the repression had continued. The Bahrain Independent Commission of Inquiry, the BICI, conducted a thorough investigation of events and found that the government had systematically violated the human rights of the Bahraini citizens. The report also included some two dozen recommendations. I know we'll talk a little bit about this today. Many of those deal with attempts to address or redress what had happened rather than the root causes of the grievances that brought tens of thousands of Bahrainis into the streets. Of course, the ongoing drama in Bahrain is being played out against the larger narrative of the Arab Spring. Bahrain is a important strategic country, if for no other reason than it hosts the U.S. fleet. Now, it's not surprising for all these reasons that there have been a host of Bahrain-related events in Washington over the past week or so, but few, if any of them, have featured the voices of Bahraini activists who participated in the protests or who were otherwise involved and continue to be involved in the struggle for democracy and human rights in Bahrain. What I'd like to do is introduce our distinguished panelists who are going to help us understand what transpired in Bahrain and possibly a way forward from the current crisis. I know that short bios were passed out, but let me just quickly tell you who we have here. Maryam Al-Khawaja, who is in the middle, is head of the Foreign Relations Section of the Bahrain Center for Human Rights, which is based in Bahrain. She's a member also of a very well-known family of activists. Her dad currently sits in prison. Her sister was arrested last February, and again, Maryam, if I'm not mistaken, again over the weekend,
Sunday.
On Sunday as well. She had left Bahrain in March of last year, and has not returned for fear of arrest by the authorities. Husain Abdullah, all the way on the end, is a naturalized U.S. citizen, originally from Bahrain. He is the director of Americans for Democracy and Human Rights in Bahrain, a U.S.-based advocacy organization, and I can attest to his being a tireless advocate for political reform in his homeland. Sitting to my immediate right, Jalil al-Radhi is a Bahraini national who fled the country after Saudi forces entered Bahrain to help crush the demonstrations. He lost his brother and his brother-in-law in the February 14th movement. He is currently residing in the United States and is wanted by the Bahraini authorities because of his work. Let me say one other thing, which is I've asked our speakers to talk for not more than 7 minutes to leave us plenty of time for Q&A. And we extended an invitation to the Bahraini ambassador, Huda Nonu, or a representative of the Bahraini government to appear, but they declined. I would note that there is a Bahraini government-sponsored delegation that's here in Washington this week. And some of the members actually may be here, and I will gladly recognize them to pose a question and offer a comment when we move to question and answers. So with that, let me start with Maryam, and also I would ask you maybe to also give us a very brief update for those who may not have been, like you, up all night corresponding with your friends in Bahrain.
Good morning, everyone. Of course, yesterday was the one-year anniversary of the beginning of the protests in Bahrain. The protesters had decided starting Sunday that they would attempt to go back to what was the Pearl Square. Of course, the Pearl Square monument was demolished by the Bahraini government because it caused, quote-unquote, bad memories for the government. But the protesters had anyway decided that they would go back and try to reclaim that area. Since the very early hours of the morning, it was around, I think, midnight here in D.C., when Twitter started becoming full of people writing that they were headed towards the Pearl Square. It wasn't an organized mass demonstration. It was basically individuals just waking up in the morning, putting their clothes on, and then heading out to the square. The majority of protesters were only armed with a Bahraini flag. Some of them were carrying a Quran. Some of them went in their cars. Some of them went walking. They were faced with the usual kind of repression. We, according to eyewitnesses, we already know that the Bahraini government had deployed further forces of the military in that area. Eyewitnesses also saw, reportedly, Saudi forces coming in over the bridge during the weekend. Of course, it's difficult to verify a lot of this information, so we have to depend on eyewitnesses and people who see things on the ground. A lot of the protesters were attacked. A lot of them were arrested. Amongst those arrested was the president of the Bahrain Center for Human Rights, Nabil Rajab. He was detained for several hours and then released later during the night. My colleague, Sayed Yusuf, who also works at the Bahrain Center for Human Rights, was also briefly detained and then released. There were six U.S. activists who are working as part of the Bahrain Witness Initiative, which was an initiative started by activists in Bahrain who invited international observers to come into the country, given that the Bahraini government is trying to create a blackout by not allowing media and NGOs into the country. Of course, within the last month and a half approximately, at least three NGOs have not been allowed into the country, one of them being Freedom House, as well as quite a number of journalists who wanted to be in the country to cover the protests. So some of these observers actually were able to get into the country. Six of them were detained yesterday and then deported at 2 a.m. in the morning. All of them were U.S. citizens. They were not allowed access to a lawyer during their detention before the deportation. There were reportedly, again, it's very difficult to confirm all of the information because of the large number of cases and the small number of people working at the Bahrain Center. But also according to Al-Wufaq and the Bahrain Center, we estimate that the number of arrests reached around 150 protesters who were arrested yesterday. A number of them were released during the evening and then also at night. Today, again, there are protesters who are attempting to go back to what was the Pearl Square, and they've also been arrested. There were at least nine women amongst those who were arrested. Some of them were girls between the ages of 12 and 18. There were raids on homes where the riot police and the security forces went inside the villages and then started breaking into people's homes, shooting tear gas, and looking for protesters. There was at least one confirmed case by the Bahrain Human Rights Society of a protester who was thrown off of a rooftop by the security forces. There was another confirmed case of a protester being hit by a riot police jeep. Of course, it's become pretty, it's not something scarce that we hear of a case of riot police attempting to run over protesters, and there have been deaths due to that in the past. And he reportedly broke both his legs due to this incident. So basically it was a situation of mass arrests using a lot of force and violence. There was also retaliation from some of the protesters. We did see during the time when the riot police went, there were armored Humvees that went inside the villages and were driving at very, very fast speeds. And there's at least one video showing a protester from a rooftop throwing Molotov cocktails at these vehicles. Now, to put things in context, of course, at the center, we do not condone violence, and we have time and time again advised the protesters to stay peaceful. But also, it's important to see things through context, given that the protesters have, to the most part, and continue to be, to the most part, peaceful. Even yesterday, the protests were, to the most part, peaceful. But there was a group of youth who announced that they were starting an initiative of what they called self-defense. And they announced that if the security forces decide to go into villages, attack families, especially women and children, that these small number of youths would come out with Molotov cocktails and rocks and try to run them out of the villages. Now again, they call this self-defense, the government calls it violence. It's all dependent on where you're looking at it from. Again, we do not condone violence, and we have time and time again asked the protesters to stay peaceful. But I think it's important to stress that, to the most part, protesters are still peaceful. It's a very small group that have started retaliating. In general, and I'm going to round up with this, the same amount of violations that we have been documenting for the past year in Bahrain, namely torture, arbitrary arrests, extrajudicial killings, kidnappings, raids between 1 and 4 a.m. in the morning, using excessive force against protesters on the streets, that continues to happen today, post the BICI report, which was commissioned by the king. Especially the activists were hoping that the BICI report would come as an opportunity for the Bahraini government to change things, and as they said, to turn a new page. Unfortunately, that hasn't happened. I found it very, very concerning that the Bahraini king, in an interview with Der Spiegel, said that there are no political prisoners in Bahrain, but rather criminals who have been imprisoned. And it's concerning because that appears to say that they are not willing to deal with these cases as per the recommendations of the BICI report, and then to release them because these were cases of freedom of expression. And despite, of course, the documentation of the severity of the torture that has been used in the prison facilities. So like I was saying, that in a nutshell, the same violations that we've been covering for the past year are still ongoing in Bahrain. Unfortunately, the only thing that has changed is that the Bahraini government is now able to use the BICI report as a tool to push under the rug all of the violations that they've already committed and to continue committing them, while engaging the international community in a discussion about politics and about the laws and what they can introduce to reform, while they're still committing the same violations on the ground. You know, there were several recommendations that should have been implemented from day one. The Bahraini government doesn't need a report to tell them that they shouldn't be torturing prisoners. They don't need a report to tell them they should not be using excessive force and killing protesters on the streets. One of the simplest recommendations was to set up video cameras in interrogation rooms to make sure that prisoners are not tortured. This has yet to happen, and we still have received reports that prisoners continue to be tortured, and that even during the interrogations, in some cases, prisoners are not even allowed lawyers. So to end with that, the situation in Bahrain continues to be what it was last year. We haven't seen the progress that the government of Bahrain keeps talking about, but we hope that is something that is going to come in the future, hopefully with international pressure. Thank you.
Thanks. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for Freedom House for hosting this event. It's been 1 year since the people of Bahrain rose up with demands. They were very much similar to some other countries who had this Arab Revolution, and also to some extent different. They were demanding political reform, they were demanding a parliamentary system that has teeth. They were demanding to keep the ruling family in their post, however, a true and real constitutional monarchy where there is a place for political process, political grievances, true representation. Like Robert said, I direct an organization called Americans for Democracy and Human Rights in Bahrain. A few minutes talking about that. We as a Bahraini American, we got together, a bunch of us created this group much earlier before February 14th, 2011. We started coming to the Hill, meeting our representative from different states, advocating for a policy that our country, the United States, has with Bahrain, where we would like to see democracy and human rights included. Right now, we have a policy that is unilateral, where we only emphasize on security because of the Fifth Fleet. What we wanted to see is a multilateral relationship where issues of democracy and human rights be discussed. Now, the situation in the country after 1 year since the uprising started has not gotten any better. As a matter of fact, gotten worse. Amnesty International, in a release yesterday, stated that torture is still being conducted in Bahrain. The Bahraini authorities still torturing political prisoners. There are a bunch of well-known political figures in prison right now. Are on hunger strike. The well-known human rights defender, Abdullah Al-Khawaja, is in a serious condition. We're very concerned about his health as he's going on his hunger strike. The Bahraini government, we believe, still think that they can resolve the situation in the country, this political quagmire that they have created by inviting foreign troops into the country, by attacking peaceful, by destroying religious places, by firing people from their jobs because of their political view, by security means. We believe that somehow there is a shield between the ruling family and reality. I mean, if you read the interview that Maryam briefly talked about, that the king had with the German magazine, when he denied that there is political opposition, or when he denies that there are political prisoners or torture or political problem in the country. I'm quoting an advocate here in Bahrain, or a human rights defender. He said he's taking the Gaddafi pill, or somehow he's wondering whether he was sober or not. I mean, the whole world is talking about Bahrain need political reconciliation, and when you have the king, the ruler of the country, claim that there is no political problem, I don't know how can we move forward. The Bahraini government, to resolve this problem, need to come up with some good gestures, need to show not only the people of Bahrain, but the international community, including the Western governments, who are very closely allied with Bahrain, and are not applying the pressure that need to be applied to end this situation, that they're serious about what they're talking. They're talking about reform, they're talking about reconciliation. If you're serious about reconciliation, first you need to release all political prisoners. That need to end and end now. You need to allow all the people to go back to their work, to their original post, not make them sign pledges and punish them for what they've done. I mean, there are still over 1,000 people that are not allowed back to work. You need to end this war against doctors, against physicians in Bahrain. You need to immediately start building all the religious places, not only four, and then come up with different excuses for the other religious site. You need to end this media campaign that attacking the religious belief of the majority of the people of Bahrain. If the Bahraini, if you just watch the Bahraini state TV for a couple of hours of day, in a day, you would believe that there is a mentality in the government to discredit more than half of the population. I will end with this. The Bahraini government cannot have a serious dialogue with the opposition while you have majority of them sitting in prison. The Bahraini government cannot have a serious solution to Bahrain while they are spending millions and millions of dollars buying arms to use it against civilians and peaceful protesters. Quoting one of the activists in Bahrain, they look upon our position, the United States position in Bahrain, similar to the position of Russia in Syria. If we spend, the United States government, if we spend 10% of the effort we're spending in Russia, in Syria today, I think the Bahraini situation would have been resolved a long time ago. There is a lack of political willingness. Somehow, the Fifth Fleet will be in danger if there is a political solution, or if there is a democracy or some kind of representation in the government, I think this argument lacks credible pieces to it. What we've been advocating for a long time, and even before the revolution, that if there is not a serious political process in the country, things is going to get worse, and things actually will get worse. Till now, the majority of the protesters, as Maryam said, peaceful. We're going to push for that. Hopefully, that will be the case till this one day will be resolved. But right now, there is a feeling of desperation on the street, and desperation only going to create something that we all hope we never see in Bahrain.
Thank you,
Husain.
Jalil?
Yeah.
Please.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Jalil Radhi. I'm just here to share my personal experience and the trauma that happened to me personally and my family. I lost a brother and a brother-in-law. My brother-in-law was shot from a close range on the 17th of February last year. And after that, on the 15th of March, my brother went missing. And we reported him missing to the police station there in our area. And we were kind of searching for him at the hospitals, and they've been denying that they do have any information about him. And we had to go to the military hospital. We have been denied from the main gate by a civilian armed officer, but I don't see any rank on him because he was just wearing civil, but he was armed, and I believe he was from the military. From the main gate, we gave him the name, and he said, no, he's not here. That's not even checking with the list or go through the system. Anyway, on the 19th of the same month, we received a call from the authority that someone is matching the description of the missing person at Salmaniya Hospital. We went there and we identified him. It was a body, of course, of my brother. And with a report, a medical report, it was done already, stating that the cause of death was injuries. And we were not so convinced with that, so we refused to receive the body, and we said, you have to give us a detail. Then they came up with another medical report stating that he do have a crack at the skull with internal bleeding that lead to death. Somehow, anyway, we had no choice than signing and receiving the body. But when we got the body, that is that what we saw there, and what we documented as well, it's all documented, does not match the report at all. My brother was shooted in the leg. That's not mentioned in the report at all. And detained, this is the conclusion that we came to, that they shooted him in the leg. It wasn't a fatal injury. And he was beaten to death. And practically they broke every single bone in his body. And this is all documented. This is actually my personal experience. And after that, we've not been left alone. My family have been harassed. From time to time, they raid to our house, which the house now, the family house, there is only my father, he's an older man, and my mother. Luckily, I'm not there, so I'm been out of the country because I don't know what could happen. Until now, we are harassed. From time to time, they come and they flood they just flood our house with tear gas, unfortunately, and we with no reason. To that. So this is something that I want to tell you about it. During my present, when I was in Bahrain, and I saw the act of the security forces there. Unfortunately, they pick you according to your name that would count. Sometimes some of the family names that kind give the indication that you are a Shia, for example, from your name, or your residential address. So that happened to me more than once at the checkpoint. And you get humiliated according to that. This is one of the things that I wanted to do because it was, to me, it's just my personal experience I wanted to share with everybody here.
Thank you. Let me exercise the prerogative of the chair just to get us started. Let me pose one question, if I may, to the panelists, and then we'll open it up for comments and questions from the audience. Common sense would seem to suggest that the upheaval that we're seeing, the political upheaval in Bahrain, has exacerbated existing cleavages, sectarian and otherwise. If you agree, how can those divisions be overcome under either current or some envisioned different political configuration?
Well, I think it's very important to understand what the situation is like to begin with before we can understand how to solve it. The protests once started in Bahrain, and this is a misconception that I found floating around quite often, was not because of, it wasn't because that there is systematic marginalization and discrimination against the Shia community in Bahrain. That was never even part of the demands that the protesters made when they first came out. When the protests first started, the first set of demands that came out from the protesters were all about reform, constitutional reform, as my colleague Husain was saying here. They made sure to announce that they were youth and that they were not religiously or politically affiliated with anyone. And I think that's the reason that when we were in the Pearl Square and I was there myself, there were all factions of Bahraini society there, whether they were Sunni or Shia or otherwise. Of course, what the government did, as all authoritarian governments do, is try to divide and conquer. They did this through trying to make it seem like the situation is Sunni versus Shia. They did this by creating a almost completely sectarian crackdown. Now, when they targeted the protesters, they targeted the majority of protesters because they were Shia, or on a Shia basis. Of course, the first political prisoner from these protests was a Sunni, and he was actually an ex-military man. One of the most prominent leaders who is today in prison, and President Obama has spoken about these leaders who need to be released back in May 2011, and they're still in prison today, is Ibrahim Sharif, another Sunni persona who's also very, very well respected by both Sunnis and Shias alike. But when the government cracked down, they cracked down on an entire sect. They demolished mosques, they desecrated graves, they went after people's religious, the religious places. And when they arrested people, almost in every single case that we've documented, if not all of them, they always refer to the person's sect, always using derogatory terms and referring to them as being Shia. Now, the reason why they did this, in my opinion, was because they wanted to create this idea that this was because these people were Shia, and to create this divide within the society that is Shia versus Sunnah. One thing that doesn't help is the way that the media frames it. The media, time and time again, frames the situation in Bahrain as the Shia uprising against the Sunni monarchy. Protesters did not come out because they're Shia, and they did not come out because the monarchy is Sunni. This is a case of oppressor versus oppressed. It's a case of loyalist versus non-loyalist. You can be Shia and you can be loyalist and you can be very comfortable in Bahrain today. And you can be Sunni and be non-loyalist like Ibrahim Sharif and be in prison today and subjected to torture. And this is something that needs to be understood, that the media, when they frame the situation in this perspective, they're actually helping add to this idea of creating a sectarian situation. Fortunately, the protesters themselves, even today, and despite the crackdown by the government, continue to say, no Shia, no Sunni, only Bahraini. And I think this is a very positive situation, because we don't know how long that's going to last, given the way that the government has dealt with the situation and trying to frame it as a Sunni Shia issue. So I think the way to move forward is, again, the first thing that needs to happen, you cannot have political reconciliation without stopping the human rights violations first. You cannot talk about political dialogue or bringing, you know, political opposition to the table and talking about how to resolve the issue if people are still being shot at in the streets, if you still have political prisoners who are being tortured. These issues, the human rights violations, need to stop first. And then we can start talking about what are the political solutions that can be taken. How do you bring people back to the dialogue table?
Just add a little bit to what Maryam said. The Bahrain government used an old strategy in the political science books called divide and conquer. Every oppressive government does that. They seen that the best way to get this unity breaking in Bahrain. And now, let me give you just a background. Sunni in Bahrain with Shia have been living side beside each other for a long time. I mean, we intermarriages, families intertwine. I mean, a personal example, my mother is Sunni. I have uncles in Bahrain, Sunni, and my father is Shia. Jalil sitting here has Sunnis, his family members married to from Sunni Bahraini family members. So a sectarian divide that the government hyped into the beginning, yes, was there because of this media bombard, this media attack, and made it into like the all of a sudden all these Shia wanted to come and kill the Sunnis in the in their homes and also given weapons to some civilian thugs in Bahrain to attack Shia student in the university and made it into a sectarian issue. However, when all this dust settled, right, what we see right now, we see now lots of Sunni political leaders in Bahrain created semi-committee to go back to the Crown Prince Initiative, those 7 points that the government offered to the political parties, and only 14 hours later, Saudi troops entered. So I wonder whether they were really serious about those 7 points. Now, these Sunni leaders, or majority of them are Sunni political leaders in Bahrain, are trying to create this coalition and go back to the 7 points the Crown Prince offered. Now, why did I get? What does that mean? That means that there is an awareness. It is not a sectarian issue. It is a political issue. You cannot solve the semi-divide or this created divide in the country between the two sects that they were. They never had problem. They lived in some areas, like in Muharraq, like in Isa town in Bahrain, and never. There are mosques close to each other. There are religious places close to each other for these sects. The way to resolve this feelings in the country by resolving the political problem. You cannot talk about the Bahraini fabric, and that's what the Bahraini government is doing. You know, the Bahraini government is spending so much money, millions and millions of dollars, on these lobbying firms, on these PR firms like Corvus and other, to paint this picture to the U.S. policy in this country that it is a sectarian problem. It is not a political problem. No, it is a political problem. These people risen up because they had political problems. These youth on February 14th, 2011, came on the street because they were fed up with the system that one family controls everything. Now imagine, 42 years, one prime minister ruling the country. As an American citizen, ask yourself, would you like to live in a system like that?
Again, now if we go back to the violation of the human rights in Bahrain and to what's happening to everybody, the things that we see is not stopped completely. And what I would be asking, according even to Bassuni report, that to bring the responsible people of to what happened, like to as a case of my brother, for example, just to bring the responsible person even on the highest level and have to go on a trial. So that's I think that's gonna help a lot in Bahrain that if you bring the responsible people of torturing or killing to justice. And this is what we are seeking all, that we are seeking justice whether according to the or within the law of Bahrain and the international law as well.
Okay, let me open it up for questions from the audience. If you could, I think, stand up. Do we have microphones? Yeah. If you could stand up and identify yourself as well, and then please keep your comment or question relatively short. I'm sure we have a lot of people asking.
Hey, yeah. By the way, that's the Woodrow Wilson Center, former Washington Post correspondent in the Middle East. My question is, I'd like your assessment of what role the foreign troops, Saudi, UAE, police, and National Guard, are playing inside Bahrain, and whether you have any evidence that they have been involved physically in the crackdown on the protesters. Thank you.
Well, of course, there's a difference between what's written in the BICI report and what we've been able to gather from eyewitnesses. Even as early as yesterday, or as late as yesterday, rather, I witnessed testimonies even from my colleagues who are on the ground that the troops who are especially very close to where the Pearl Square was, despite being dressed in Bahraini military uniform, had Saudi accents and Emirati accents. And this is a narrative that we've been hearing for months, that a lot of these troops, despite being dressed in the Bahraini uniform, are speaking with different Gulf accents. Of course, there's no way for us to prove whether these people are actually working for the army, given that the Bahraini government actually employs and politically naturalizes Arabs from other countries to serve in their forces, because the majority of people in Bahrain are not allowed into the security forces in Bahrain. Or whether they're actually coming from these foreign troops and then being dressed in Bahraini uniforms and put on the ground. There's no way to verify that. We did receive a couple of eyewitness testimonies also that the Peninsula Shield troops, did engage in the crackdown when they cleared the roundabout in mid-March. That we've received several reports of eyewitness testimonies of seeing them actually engaging in that. Of course, the BICI report said that there was no engagement, that the troops had come in to protect installments. Now, I don't know what installments they're protecting exactly, or why they need to protect installments, given that there have been no attacks on any kind of installments. Most of the attacks usually, or the clashes, happen within the residential areas where the protesters come out. But also the fact that the king, of course, kept justifying the bringing in of these troops by saying that there was an Iranian threat. Now, given that the government's own commissioned report said that there was absolutely no evidence of any Iranian involvement in these protests, that automatically eliminates that justification that has been used. So the fact that they're still in the country, and the fact that there are eyewitness testimonies that are saying that there are more troops being sent into the country, is very, very concerning. But like I said, it's very, very difficult to verify.
Okay, please.
Good morning. My name is Abtissam and I'm from Bahrain. I would like to thank Freedom House for shedding light on the events in my country and the things that I see every day. And I do agree with you, Maryam, that in order to find the solution to our problems, we need to know what the situation is. And I agree with you because you've been away since March. And I've been living there my whole life and I've seen it all every single day. And I tell you this, the protesters are not peaceful. I know this because I live next to a village where I see it, smell it, and hear it every single day. Molotov, cocktail, petrol bombs being thrown in front of my home, at my car. As I drive to work, there are metal rods, there are oil spilling on the streets. And I see it and I think, why are they doing this to my country? They are my people. And I do have the same grievances that they have. I do want better jobs. I do want better reform in the government. I want more voice for myself. I'm not happy with the government working right now. I'm not happy with the bicameral system that is not fully functional as a full-fledged democracy. However, I don't choose to stay out of Bahrain and say things about my country and report word of mouth as reports of human rights. You are a human rights activist. There is a saying in a movie, Little Black Book, and it says, omission is betrayal. And I think you're betraying the Bahraini voice because you're omitting my voice. I am no pro-government, no anti, no nothing. I'm just Bahraini, and I want my country back the way it was before all this hoopla started. I want my six best friends who are Shia that I grew up with every day to come back to me and be my friends again. I want my aunt who was divorced from her husband who was top tier Shia, Musawi, and they got divorced because his sisters told my aunt to leave her husband because of what's happening. And it was never the case. I grew up in a household where my father was an ex-military man. And he saw me tall from the beginning of the ruling of Al-Khalifa after the independence in 1971. And he never raised me as Bahraini, never raised me and told me that you are Sunni, don't be friends with Shia. I grew up next to a village where the school that I went to, the girls are from villages, and I went to their homes, ate with them, sat with them. I know that our caliber as Bahrainis is just being Bahraini. There's no Sunni, no Shia. I think what made us think of it and portray it this way is because some people want to create critical mass and gain political ground and really rally people behind them. So they use that divide as a vehicle. When I went to the roundabout...
I'm happy to have you, but can I ask you to offer a question?
One more comment and I have the question.
Okay, please.
When I went to the roundabout because I wanted a better job, I want a future for the future kids that I will have that is better for them, whether it's political or economic or whatever. And second by second, I see my voice being hijacked, and that's totally against the pinnacle and the center of human rights meaning. My question is for Freedom House and everyone, why aren't the people like me on this panel? Why do we hear reports of killings and torture and everything, and not people like me who are not affiliated with anyone? I just want my country back to me and to all Bahrainis, regardless of our backgrounds, sit and talk there and say that they are not happy with the government, not happy with everything. They just want to sit,
okay,
civilize, and talk.
Thank you.
Okay, let me ask you first if you want
to... Sure. Of course, I did already talk about that there has been groups within the protesters who have announced that they will be retaliating against the forces. So I have acknowledged that that does happen. Of course, like I said, it needs to be seen through context. When you have a situation where a year later, you have more than 60 people killed, you have thousands tortured, you have thousands imprisoned, you have thousands sacked, when you have the families of those who were killed harassed and targeted by the security forces, Radhi here is not the only member of a family of someone who was killed that's been harassed and targeted. We receive reports from families in the center time and time again that because they have a member of their family who was killed during the unrest, they are time and time again being targeted. In the case of Ali Mumin, who was killed on the 17th of February, I was there in the roundabout myself. I saw what happened. His family, his two brothers, have both been arrested. One has been sentenced to 2 years imprisonment, and the other one, who's a student, is also now in prison. The father is left with no sons. And this is not a case that is singular to one family. This is a case that's widespread. I am sorry that there are people, and I understand that there are people who find it very disturbing that they can't go to the mall or that they can't go to their jobs on time, that, you know, there are blocks put up on the road. The blocks are put there because the protesters are run over by the security forces in their jeeps. So they set up these blocks so that the riot police cannot drive fast into their villages and run them over. It might be bad for other people, yes. Does it harm the interests of other residents? Yes. But it's a life and death matter for some of these protesters. That's why I think that the situation does need to be seen through context. This word betrayal, it's been used time and time again in Bahrain. Anyone who comes out and protests is told that they're committed a betrayal against their government. There are numbers, numerous, countless accounts of human rights reports from Human Rights Watch, from Amnesty International, from Freedom House, from all of these different international organizations who have documented the ongoing human rights violations in Bahrain. This is not something just the Bahrain Center for Human Rights is talking about. Up until November, the Bahrain Center for Human Rights was saying that there are around 1,500 political prisoners in Bahrain. We said that the majority of them have been tortured. We said that there have been these many deaths. The BICI report, which was commissioned by the government, came out and said that there are 3,000 political prisoners at a time when the Bahrain Center was told that they were exaggerating numbers. Now, this is the reality of the situation in Bahrain. There's a lot of misinformation going on. Yes, I understand that there are people who think that, you know, we need to go back to the way it was before February 14th. Unfortunately, for a lot of people, that's not possible. There are people who are severely tortured. They need rehabilitation. There are people who are still being tortured. For example, the freedom of expression cases, who are still not released. Like I said, President Obama spoke about them in May 2011. The BICI report documented their cases. Why are they still in prison? These are people who should be on the dialogue table. Now, when we're looking at the situation from that perspective, like I said, I can appreciate that there are people who don't like what's happening because they can't go on with their daily lives as usual. But at the end of the day, there are grave human rights violations that are taking place. Let's stop that so we can all go back to living in a way that we can appreciate and be comfortable with.
I'm very happy to see Ibtissam Bahar here. I mean, as a Bahraini citizen, I'm always happy to see my fellow Bahraini come here and share their opinion. However, in the same tone, I would like to tell Ibtissam that I condemn any protester will throw a rod at you, will throw a Molotov cocktail at you, will prevent you from going to your work. However, those protesters, the Pisam, are not against you. They're not against you. They're against the system that is basically violating their rights on single day. I can feel your frustration. And I would like you also to, in the same tone, talk a little bit about the Shia who are not allowed in the military. I also want you to talk about the mosque who were destroyed. I also want you to talk about the gerrymandering. I also want you to talk about the political prisoners. I also want you to talk about those mothers who lost their sons and daughters and fathers. I also want you to talk about basically who's paying for this trip, how you guys are related to Corvus. The Bahraini government want to send you this message that, and we heard it from Ibtissam, people wanted jobs. It's not about jobs. It's about political rights. It's about political process. It's about having a representative government. Also, Ibtissam, I would like to hear from you. How would you feel about a prime minister been ruling the country for 42 years? I'm sure, Ibtissam, you're going to condemn that too. So, ladies and gentlemen, it is not about how many cocktail, Molotov been thrown. Let's ask the question, who has the prisons? Who has the weapons? Who has the army who are brought from outside? Who has the mercenaries? Who has the political support from United States, from UK? People of Bahrain who are protesting for rights that we enjoy here are not against their fellow citizen. They are against a system that's blocking their effort to have a peaceful Bahrain that we all can enjoy.
Thank you. Any other? Please. Yeah. Please identify yourself.
Yeah. My name is Deb Horan, and I am a former journalist that covered the Middle East for quite a while, although I've never been to Bahrain. While I was covering the Middle East, I wrote a lot of stories about women in the Middle East, especially Palestinian women organizing protests, Egyptian women working, for change in that country, in Jordan, elsewhere. And I wonder if you can talk a little bit about the role that women have played in Bahrain, and especially in the years prior to this uprising, because I mean, I understand that they didn't just suddenly appear when the political upheaval started, but rather that they've been in the mix for years. So I'm curious to hear about that.
Well, I think the women play just as important a role as the men, and I'm not only saying this because I'm a woman, but I think the women have played a very, very important role in the revolution in Bahrain. They've always been on the front lines, as well as the men. At least 50% of all protests are women. They've had to pay the same price that the men have. They've been imprisoned, they've been tortured. There's a case of one woman who was shot in the head while she was driving her car. So they're just as targeted as the men are. But I think it's also very important to recognize that women in Bahrain are also pretty empowered. And I think you can see that clearly from myself and Ibtissam. They're not women who will allow their voices to be taken away from them. And I think that's also why a lot of women, especially from the protest side, felt very, very offended when they read the king's interview with Der Spiegel, where he said, well, I introduced the emergency law because the women were crying for help, and as a gentleman, I had to do something about it. I don't think you necessarily have to be a feminist to find that offending. But the fact of the situation is that women have taken a leading role, even despite the violence that's been used. You can see even yesterday with the return to the Pearl Square, there were a lot of women who participated in that. There's been a lot of videos where you see women trying to free, especially children, from the grasp of security forces. There are hundreds of videos showing that, where the riot police will come and try to arrest little 12, 14-year-old boys, and the woman will go out and try to release them. And they usually get beaten, sprayed in the face, things like that. But this is something that we've seen time and time again, and women are taking a leading role, and I think this is going to reflect also on the situation post this revolution, because I think women are not going to allow their voices to be taken away from them. After the revolution is over, they're definitely going to play a leading role also in building up the country after the revolution finishes. The one thing that I think is important to point out as well, that yes, we have been talking a lot about the violence or the what the protesters are calling self-defense, but I think it's also important to notice or recognize the kind of violence used by the security forces, because the security forces are not only using tear gas as a lethal weapon. They're not only using sound bombs, rubber bullets, and these burnt pellet shotguns, which have caused a number of deaths in Bahrain. The tear gas, of course, has caused 15 plus deaths from suffocation because of the way they use it. But they've also been using things like Molotov cocktails. There are videos out there showing riot police throwing Molotov cocktails at protesters and at people's homes. There are a number of videos showing riot police throwing iron rods at protesters. There's been at least one case where there's a girl who got hit with an iron rod in the head. And according to eyewitnesses, it was a riot police officer who threw it at her. Now, of course, the government later on said that it was the protesters who killed her. But of course, going to her Facebook page and so on, you could see that she was part of the protests. And so it wouldn't make sense for the protesters to kill her. But at the same time, also looking at the difference in the amount of deaths, the government keeps saying that the protesters are using lethal force. Now again, I do not condone any kind of violence, we condemn it. But again, you have to look at it through context. The protesters, the police deaths that have occurred during February, March, and around that time period. Since then, we haven't seen a single death in the police forces or in the military, whereas you continue to see protesters killed. January has actually been the deadliest month since March, which I think, again, is a very interesting situation to look at, because this is post-BICI report, where the government is supposed to be working on the recommendations and reforms. So to say that the largest number of protesters have been killed in a span of 1 month after the BICI report, and then compared to the rest of the months, I think also is very good evidence of where we're headed today.
Yeah, right here in the middle, this gentleman, and then,
Thank you. Peter Shutley from Brookings. Two quick questions. One is, what is the presence of the U.S. Fifth Fleet? In other words, how many people do they employ? How much do they contribute to the economy? Are they visible, you know, soldiers all over town, or are they sort of off to the side and barely seen? And my second question is, to what extent does the Saudi government pressure or influence the Bahraini government to take these kind of actions, or are the actions decided by the Bahraini government themselves?
The first part of your question to the U.S. Personnel, we do have in Bahrain 16,000 military personnel based in Bahrain. And the U.S. Navy have been in Bahrain for the last 60 years. And yes, the people are visible there, and they've been always visible. There are residents side to side with the Bahraini people, even though most of them there are in certain area in Bahrain, but still a good number of them. There are everywhere in Bahrain, and we never had a problem with that because they never been like a case for us or a target. I'm just answering the first part of the question of the military present in Bahrain, the U.S. military present.
The economic impact is huge. According to many sources, the U.S. base in Bahrain contribute between $200 to $220 million per year, and that's a big number for Bahrain's economy. The military presence is known. You can see a lot of uniform or non-uniform American soldiers in Bahrain. Actually, some of them even were in the roundabout. They came to the roundabout. They had the Arabic coffee. They had haircuts there in the roundabout when those good old days were in Bahrain, late February, early March, when people were breathing freedom. Now, the second part, also we use that as a leverage. Whenever we talk, or we would like it to be used as a leverage, whenever we talk with congressional offices, we tell them that if there is a place that the United States has any diplomatic, political leverage, is Bahrain. We have the base, which is not only important to us, it is important to the ruling family. The ruling family in Bahrain gained its legitimacy, its security, its safety net because we're there. So we should use that to pressure them and influence them to do the right thing. Now, when it comes to the Saudi influence, I think it's naive not to see it. It's obvious. Saudi Arabia is pressuring Bahrain to take certain policies toward its population. However, that influence was invited by the Al Khalifa himself. They are the one who seek that influence. They are the one who went to Saudi Arabia. The king has been visiting Saudi Arabia on a daily basis. Some even say they don't know whether he's here or in Riyadh because he's there so much. There are talks now that Saudi Arabia might even unity or annexation of Bahrain. That would be a disaster. I don't know where we're going to stand. We mean the United States government. There is certainly an influence. It's a negative influence. However, it was invited by the Al Khalifa. It was not forced upon them.
I hope my driving privileges don't get taken away. but on a very quick point, I think it's also very important to note that to a lot of Bahraini protesters, the United States has become to Bahrain what Russia is to Syria. It's basically a government that's selling weapons to an oppressive regime that's committing widespread human rights violations. And I think for U.S. Reputation everywhere, not only in the Middle East, that is very, very damaging.
On the end here.
Right here. Hi. Yeah, I'm Peter Vetner. I'm a blogger student. What can American citizens do from here to help human rights in Bahrain and maybe in other places? There are people in our government, powerful Americans, who don't really care. As long as the oil is flowing, as long as it's stable. There are interest groups, allies. What can we do about Saudi Arabia? What can American citizens do about our own government? What can we do about the Saudis? How can we stop this? Because if anything's going to change, it's not going to come from the top down. It's not going to be that some American leadership turns this around. The American people are going to have to do it. Aren't we? Why should we keep financing this kind of thing? How can we stop it?
If you guys will, I'll take this first. You can do a lot. I mean, our group is a testimony for advocacy power. You have a vote, you have a representative, and you have two senators. If the American people start writing to their member of Congress, raising concern that what is happening in Bahrain is unacceptable. Selling arms to a country that violates human rights on a daily basis should not take place. Give you a simple example. Alabama has probably the largest Bahraini American community in the United States. We met with our member of Congress, our two senators, and in 2008, the first ever resolution was introduced in the Senate on Bahrain. That came because of advocacy work, because people met with their representative, met with their senator, and because of the power of vote that we still have in a democracy, we were able to get somewhere. First ever briefing was done in Bahrain was done in 2008 because of the advocacy of the American people who pushed their representative to have something on Bahrain. First ever hearing happened, was chaired by Congressman McGovern and Congresswoman Donna Edwards because the Bahraini American community in Maryland pushed her and requested her to help to hold hearings on human rights violations in Bahrain. So you can do a lot. One voice is not weak. One voice is a lot of voices. Because when you send a letter, when you email, when you call, that actually gets to the member of Congress or their legislative assistant, and that become an issue that they follow. And whenever the State Department hear from 10, 15, 20 member of Congress about an issue, that raise an alarm, and then hopefully, the hope is positive things come through, and that's what we do. We bring different Bahraini activists from different backgrounds, whether they're part of our group or not, to D.C. to meet member of Congress, to meet congressional staffers, to tell them what is happening in Bahrain, need to stop, is unacceptable.
Okay, I can't see the rest of it. Go ahead. Hang on a second. Sarah, is anybody? Yeah.
Zainab Swage from Board of Trustees of Freedom House. Thank you very much for the informative panel. I really, you know, we all hear about what's happening in Bahrain, and we are, you know, always thinking about the human rights violations over there. My question is about the future. What would the opposition in Bahrain, what they are planning to do? It's a year after a lot of damages, many people have been killed. Prisons are filled with people, and how could we help as a human rights organization here in the U.S.? We've been trying, but for the next, for the upcoming future, this year, what is the plan, and would the Bahraini opposition continue the fight against dictatorship?
Well, I think there's quite a lot that can be done. One of the things that worries us is the blackout. The fact that Freedom House has not been allowed into the country, Physicians for Human Rights has not been allowed in, Human Rights First has not been allowed in, journalists are not being allowed in. That for us is very, very concerning because it means the government's narrative and information or misinformation is more or less the only thing coming out and is being reported. One of the things we keep hearing from the United States administration is that Well, we need more information. And of course, the best information comes from the U.S. NGOs who are able to get in on the ground. So if the U.S. NGOs are not being allowed access, that's very, very problematic. Now, when that happened in Egypt, when there was an attack on NGOs in Egypt, that caused a huge fuss. And I think it shouldn't be given less importance in Bahrain as well. It's very, very important that human rights organizations are able to get in Bahrain on the ground and document the violations that are ongoing so that we can have a stronger presence in the international community and also tell the governments around the world that this is what's happening and this is the documentation for it. Unfortunately, for us as a Bahraini human rights organization, it's difficult because we have a very, very limited amount of people working with us. We've been banned and closed down in 2004 in Bahrain, so we continue to work illegally. We are recognized internationally by everyone, whether it's governments or NGOs, but inside Bahrain, it's very, very difficult for us to have access. So when we do any kind of documentation, it's usually based on testimonies or based on people who are then released and able to show us what they were subjected to. But we don't actually have access to documentation that the government does because they won't recognize our role. So again, that's where the international organizations step in. Now, unfortunately for the Bahrain government, anyone who criticizes them is dubbed Iranian influence. So suddenly Amnesty International became Iranian influence. Human Rights Watch, of course, is a colonialist group that's trying to disrupt the peace in Bahrain. So they are going to try to frame it in that way to prevent these groups from coming into the country. But I think it's very important that these groups keep pressuring the government, keep documenting the human rights violations, and keep trying to get in. And then making sure that the U.S. administration also knows that it's not okay for them to be selling arms to a government that is continuing to commit human rights violations and is continuing to ignore the pleas and cries for help that is coming from the advice that is coming from the NGOs on the outside. I think that's it.
Your question was two parts, the future and what can you do. The people of Bahrain owe Freedom House a lot, owe so many other NGO, human rights organization, their gratitude because of the work you guys have been doing and hopefully will continue doing. As I mentioned earlier, the government of Bahrain has tons of money to spend on lobbying firm, PR. You guys are our lobbying firm. The NGOs, Freedom House, Human Rights Watch, and others are the lobbying, are the voice of the people of Bahrain. Raise this moral pressure, raise this moral temperature toward the administration that is not okay. Gosh, they didn't like what I said. That's not okay. That's not okay for us to push for human rights somewhere and ignore it completely. It's not only hurt us in Bahrain, it hurt us in the region. This Arab revolution united these youth. So the youth in Syria, when they see that you're supporting them strongly, and they appreciate that, but at the same time, when they meet a Bahraini activist in Geneva or somewhere other and see your stand in Bahrain, they question the whole credibility of the United States. That one thing. The future in Bahrain. What we're hoping for, what the political opposition is hoping for, is political dialogue. Is political outcome. There is no way this can be resolved in security way. The government still believe that if they apply the pressure, if they bring more mercenaries from Pakistan and Yemen and other friendly countries to the regime, somehow these protests are going to disappear. It's actually going to make them even more powerful, make them, because there is no fear factor anymore. You know, they've seen it all. They've seen the killing, the torture, the humiliation. They've seen all kind of degrading behavior from the government that probably, you know, they don't expect anything worse to happen. So the only outcome in Bahrain is political solution. And no political solution can happen unless there is a ground for it. And the ground is, the biggest one in my opinion, is releasing all political prisoners.
If I could just add one very quick point. I think the reason why things have not changed in Bahrain is because the Bahraini government doesn't have an incentive to do it. There's been no consequences for their actions internationally. We've seen, at a time when we've seen all of the other countries involved in the Arab Spring get at least a special session in the UN Council, the Human Rights Council, or the Security Council, where we've seen economic embargoes or economic sanctions on certain countries, you know, consistent, strong condemnation of the violations coming from countries like the United States, none of that has been done for Bahrain. So why should the Bahraini government have any incentive to change if they're being sold weapons as they commit these atrocities? I think the change will come when we see enough international pressure exerted, and a lot of that comes from the NGOs.
Just to pick up on the one point, which is that, I mean, one of the most important and valuable contributions that Freedom House can make is to exactly what you're seeing here, is to amplify the voice of those who are involved in the struggle. That's what we do. It's one of the things that we do all over the world, not just here domestically, but also internationally in various fora, whether it's Geneva or the Human Rights Council, but especially here in the U.S. in Congress. What we did mention before is that initially the arms deal was slated to go through several months ago, but because of the activities of some of the folks on this panel, working with Freedom House and others, there was quite a opposition in the Congress to that moving forward. And I think, again, that gave an opportunity to then elevate and illuminate what was going on. And I think that's also, it's not just a matter of illuminating what's happening on in the country, but those who, one way or the other, governments and others, who are supportive, and at one point you have to ask yourself, complicit in what is happening if they're not prepared to bring their full resources to bear on stopping it. I had a couple of here and then here.
Hi, I'm Ala Abu Zahkouk. I'm with Freedom House.
Can you
I have a very loud voice, so. like I said, Ala Abu Zahkouk with Freedom House, Middle East North Africa team. First of all, thank you so much for your courage and bravery in sharing your experiences and highlighting the grave situation that's taking place in Bahrain. I have three questions, so I'll try to keep it really compact, and if it's too long, just stop me. The first being international pressure. We've mentioned this throughout, and the two players that we've highlighted is the role of the United States and that of Saudi Arabia. What about Qatar? You know, Qatar has positioned itself as a regional player in terms of trying to bring diverse groups together from Sudan to Palestine, to the groups within Palestine, and then, you know, they also have the tool of Al Jazeera and covering it, and we know the lack of coverage that they presented with regards to Bahrain, specifically Al Jazeera Arabic. And in the early days, I think they showcased some of it in Al Jazeera English. Okay, all right. So the role of Qatar, and then who are your international friends? Who are the allies that are standing in support of human rights activities? Second question, domestically, given that there isn't that much media coverage about Bahrain, what is your assessment, or, you know, can you gauge the percentage of those who are standing in support of, you know, standing against, excuse me, the human rights violations? Because, like you said, a lot of it's been framed in terms of Shia, Sunni. If you can illuminate a little bit on that. And the last question, if it's too personal, I understand. Maryam, if you could talk a little bit about the situation of your father, when was he detained, and just the situation of political prisoners in general. Thank you.
I'm trying to remember your questions. Qatar was actually part of the Peninsula Shield that was sent to Bahrain. Given that they're part of the Gulf, it means they also fall under the auspices of Saudi Arabia. Now, Saudi Arabia is more or less the big brother in the group, and they exert their pressure or their influence over the other Gulf countries. So I really doubt that Qatar can do anything that the Saudis would not like. And unfortunately, there's a lot of double standards and hypocrisy at play at a time, you know, when we see the Gulf countries calling for freedom and democracy in Syria. They're sending troops into Bahrain to repress the protests. The King of Bahrain, actually, in his interview with Der Spiegel, also said that he gave advice to Bashar al-Assad to listen to the Syrian people. I hope he takes that advice himself and listens to his people as well. He also said that the Syrian people are the people who are going to decide whether the Syrian regime should stay or not. Again, that's advice that he should give to himself. So that I think in the situation of Qatar, I'm not sure that they could be very helpful given the geopolitical situation of the Gulf countries. As for the media, as you were saying, unfortunately, the Arab media has not been very helpful. The Saudis have a hand in a lot of the Arab media in the Middle East. Places like Al Arabiya, Al Jazeera Arabic especially. Some of them, not only do they not cover Bahrain, but they try to present it as something different, whether it's an Iranian conspiracy or, you know, a Shia uprising against the Sunnis or things like that. I mean, just 2 days ago, or was it yesterday, Al Arabiya put on an 18-minute documentary. And I remember it was titled, The Shia Terrorists in Bahrain, or something like that. And I was very surprised that they would actually very blatantly call it something like that, and then actually put it on TV. But that is something that we have been seeing happening with the media. The support that we depend on is NGO support on the outside. Basically, in countries where you have authoritarian regimes like Bahrain, it's the human rights activists who become the opposition, because they're the ones who are doing the most. Their work is basically becomes the biggest threat to the government. And that's why what we depend on the most is the organizations on the outside who can document the human rights violations that are ongoing on the ground. Locally, most people support the Bahraini revolution. I have activist friends from Syria, Tunisia, Libya, Egypt, everywhere. And they all support the Bahraini revolution. They all talk about their support to the Bahraini revolution. Yes, have there been people influenced by this calling it a Shia revolution? Yeah, there has been, definitely. Just like there are people who are buying this idea that the revolution in Syria is a Sunni revolution against the Shia government. That's not the case. Again, it's a case of a people rising up against an oppressor. It's loyalists versus non-loyalists, just as the situation in Bahrain. So it's very important to see it from that context. Going to your last question, I usually don't like to talk about personal cases. But I can very briefly talk about that, given that my father's life is in danger at the moment. I've had several members of my family arrested and tortured in Bahrain. But my father's case was the most severe. He was one of the most severe cases of torture in Bahrain. His case was documented by the BICI report. You can read it as case number 8 in the BICI report. He was also called as being one of the freedom of expression cases, and they did call for his release. He's still in prison. He's an EU citizen. He's a Danish citizen, and the Danish government has been calling for his release. And despite that, we haven't seen anything. He's currently on hunger strike. But because the reason why we think that his situation could be fatal, and it could be that it's even an amount of days, not even weeks, that he has left, it's not only because of his hunger strike, it's also because of the effect of the torture that it's had on him. He still has a broken jaw, which is the only reason why it's still held together with his face is because they've put in metal screws and metal plates that is holding his face together. And he still suffers from a lot of health complications. And I think it's very important to point out at this point that this is not something that's exclusive to my family. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of Bahraini families have very similar cases today in Bahrain. And that is one of the situations that we're dealing with, is that people who have suffered from very severe torture are still being kept in detention, are not being allowed health access. Muhammad Habib al-Muqdad is a Swedish citizen who's been sentenced so far up to 95 years imprisonment. I think he has like 9 different cases against him in court. He's also one of the severe cases of torture, and he's still in prison. I think, rounding it up, my hope is that there will be an initiative led by Denmark and Sweden, given that they have citizens who have been tortured and imprisoned in Bahrain. I don't really put too much hope or hold my breath waiting for the United States government to do much on Bahrain, given their interests in those countries. My hope is that that Denmark and Sweden will try to lead an initiative within the EU to exert pressure, first to release these two EU citizens, but then also to look, to use that as a gateway, to look at the entirety of the human rights violations in the country. Ideally, it should be there should be introduced economic sanctions against Bahrain at this point.
So, let me move over and then we'll, okay, then we can get them out. Yeah, please. If you will, please identify yourself.
Thank you very much. 2 minutes, Robert, if I may. No. My name is Husain Al-Khawaja. I'm a Bahraini. I'm a father of 2 daughters. And I've been fairly active since February on front of social media. I've met more than 200 people with different opinions on the political spectrum. I've met with government officials. I've met with opposition parties. I've even met with kids on the street. Basically, anything I can do to make sure not only my daughters, but everyone in Bahrain has a better future as far as I can as a citizen. And I've been trying to come to D.C. for a while as well, so I was, when I heard about a government trip to D.C. being organized for youth delegations, I jumped on that opportunity, and I was quite surprised when they accepted me, because firstly, I'm not sure I can be considered youth anymore, but more importantly, because I have been fairly critical of the government as I have been of the opposition. But my voice is that of a more moderate view, and the issue I want to discuss today is, I'll bring it back to what you started with, Robert, is the narrative of a divided society. And to me, that is one of the most critical issues we face today, and it's concerning to me as well, because I don't see anyone acknowledging it as much as they can. In Bahrain right now, we have a society which is extremely polarized, and from both sides, we have people who pretty much either do not acknowledge it or blame the other side on creating it and not discuss ways to resolve it. So that's where I'm coming from. And over the past year, I've seen dozens of friendships end. I've seen at least 12 marriages end for sectarian reasons. And again, it's very concerning for me. Now, just to be very clear, in my opinion, there's no negotiating human rights. If there are rights violations, you continue doing what you do, and those have to stop immediately. But when it comes to society and the political outcome people want, we do need the majority of people to agree on the way forward. And that's what we don't have today in Bahrain. That divide, whatever the reasons for it, is real and it does exist. And I think we need to sort of look at the extreme we've got today. I know people don't have, opinions aren't black and white. People are on a spectrum of opinions. But to simplify, we do have an extreme side on one end that aims towards having the complete fall of the regime. On the other hand, we have loyalists. Sometimes they're even poor, but in the frame set that nothing should change and everything should stay the same. Sorry about that.
You can try to put it in a question.
I'll end with that. Thank you very much. Now, to me, I feel unless both sides realize that there has to be a middle, it's been a year now, and clearly the solution on the street isn't working out. The security solution isn't working out. In my opinion, regardless of political reconciliation, which can only start once the government resolves all its mistakes, there is reconciliation between people. Do you agree with me that there is a way, if people come together, if we increase the clout of people and find that middle ground where demands overlap between those two extremes? You know, we can sit together, we can talk together, just like we're talking to people here. More Bahrainis should talk to each other and agree on that political outcome they want. And that could be a catalyst
for the other political reconciliation and other issues. But it should happen regardless of anything else, and not enough people are focusing on it. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. Please.
Again, happy to see you. Always happy to see Bahrainis. I agree with you that Bahrain has a problem. Now, I don't agree with you that's a social problem. It is not a social problem. Bahrain has a political problem. To resolve any problem, we need to go to the root of the problem. Why February 14th, 2011 happened? Did it happen because I didn't like you because you're Sunni, or you didn't like me because I'm Shia? No. It happened because big group of people felt that their political rights were taken away from them. I support any kind of initiative for dialogues between the people, but I take it in a suspicious way, when a government come and want to discuss social issues, in the same time ignoring that there is a political reality in the country. I take it with a grave, suspicion when I see a king saying that there is no political problems in Bahrain. I would like to hear your opinion and some opinion later on, maybe when we exchange our information. What your guys' position on a prime minister that's been ruling the country for 42 years? What's your position on women's been in prison? What's your position on a king saying that there is no political problem to resolve Bahrain issue today? And to have another discussion, Freedom House, about political parties running in a fair and free elections, we need to have political reconciliation that starts with releasing all political prisoners, not having sitting around talking about social issues.
I can agree with you that there has been, to a certain extent, a polarization on the ground. Yes, there has been. But again, I would disagree that it was done on a basis, on a sectarian basis. I think it was still done on a loyalist basis. The friends that I've lost during the revolution were not friends I lost because I'm Shia or they're Sunni. I lost those friends because they supported the government and they didn't like what I was doing, which was exposing the government for their human rights violations. And that's the difference. That's where I would disagree with you. I think it's an amazing idea. Ideally, yes, let's all sit down and talk about the social problems and how we can move forward. But when there are human rights violations happening on the ground, where will that debate really take us? When you have a government that's consistently trying to create a sectarian situation, where is that debate really going to take us? I still think, and I still confirm, that the protests in Bahrain are not completely Shia. They're not completely sectarian. There are many Sunnis that I personally know who take part in the protests on the streets. There are many Sunnis who support it on Twitter. There are Sunnis who have paid a price by going to prison and being tortured. Has the government tried to create a situation where they send a message to the Sunni community that you should be on our side because that's where your benefits lie? Yes, they have. Have they been successful? Maybe in some cases. But there are Sunnis who don't support this and who support this struggle for freedom and democracy. Again, I think, yes, it's very important to talk. But when you have grave human rights violations taking place, it's not talking that's going to take us forward. It's the human rights violations that need to be stopped first. And I think that's the situation for all of the other countries too. Like in Egypt, like in Syria, you can't have the Muslim Brotherhood and the middle class and the lower class all sitting down and discussing how to solve their social problems when SCAF is still imprisoning them and torturing them and attacking people on the streets. And it's the same thing with Syria. So I think first, we need to take those violations that are being committed by the government, stop them, and then yes, by all means, let's sit down and talk.
We've got one more question, so Courtney, I'll give you the last word, and then I'll turn to the panel for a final word or two.
Thank you. My name is Courtney Raj. I'm the Freedom of Expression Officer here at Freedom House. And I wanted to ask you specifically about the social media side of things and how that relates to coverage of the Bahrain situation. I think that we've seen social media has been very important in Syria and Bahrain for getting information out, since mainstream channels have and newspapers have largely been shut down. But could you talk a little bit about why we're not seeing the same use of some of the social media in Bahrain that we're seeing in Syria? And I wonder if you could talk about those tactics or if it has to do with the government's sophistication. And it seems like there are a lot of less attacks in the Syrian Twitter sphere than there are, for example, in the Bahrain Twitter sphere.
Well, I mean, it's a very, very vast discussion, this social media issue. You can give an entire speech about that alone, but I'll try not to. But with the, like you said, because of the absence of media coverage in Bahrain, the Bahraini people have had to resort to platforms like Twitter and Facebook to try and talk about what's going on the ground. It's been one of the only ways for them to cover the situation. And I remember about a month and a half ago, in the beginning of January, when the protest erupted in larger numbers, and the media started writing, oh, the protests come back to Bahrain. People were saying, the protests didn't come back to Bahrain. You guys stopped covering it. If you go on Twitter and Facebook, you'll realize that it's been ongoing almost every single night since February 14, 2011. It just got stopped being covered by the mainstream media. But the social media is playing a very, very important role. Now, the government of Bahrain and the government in Syria were smarter than the Mubarak era government, because they didn't switch off the internet. What they did is they launched online campaigns to try and belittle or to take down the influence that they think these protesters might have. So they launched things like, and I think they get a lot of help from the PR firms. Of course, Bahrain has 12 PR firms working for them who will help out with this. But they do things like spamming hashtags. So for example, myself, I've been to several events where I'm talking, and as soon as they find out in Bahrain that Maryam Al-Khawaja is going to this event, suddenly that timeline is completely spammed. And all you read is Maryam Al-Khawaja is working for the Iranian government, Maryam Al-Khawaja is working for the CIA, Maryam Al-Khawaja is working for the Mossad. Apparently I work for all the governments, you know? So they do those kind of things. They try to defame activists, they try to spread a lot of misinformation. Sometimes in some cases, and I've seen this with Syria as well, the people working for the government will actually spread pictures that are not from the government, or not from the country, sorry, and then try to get the protesters to pick it up, and then say, look, they're spreading pictures that are not from here, you can't trust them, they're lying. And this has happened again. So they've been using a lot of different tactics to try and bring down this influence that these different platforms have. And I mean, they've even been resorting to things like threats. I've received all kinds of threats. I've been threatened with my life, I've been threatened with rape, I've been threatened with all kinds of things for being a human rights activist. But again, I think that one thing that is building up in today's world is the importance of social media. And we're seeing that the mainstream media is more or less now reliant on these social media platforms to get information. Of course, then there's the whole issue of verification, but they are becoming very, very reliant on getting information from there and looking at people's opinions and seeing what's going on. So I think social media is something, I would disagree that it caused the revolution. I don't like the terminology, the Facebook revolution or the Twitter revolution, because I don't think that's the case. It was the youth that led these revolutions and paid a very high price for it. But I think that this was a very, very important tool that was utilized by the youth for it.
And one minute, I mean, I'm the last one to talk about social media because I don't even have a Twitter account. But however, what I've seen when people have Twitter accounts and show me that the government send these pictures, these are traitors. And I've seen sometimes my picture there and unpleasant comments beside it. The most common one is Iranian agent. And I got so much sick that I start not going to Persian restaurant, just thinking they might take my picture there and say, look, he is an Iranian agent. So
let me ask our panelists to close just with a final thought or two. Let me start with you, Jalil, and then we'll bring this to a close.
Yeah, actually, to what Mr. Kohaji referred to, yes, do we want to sit and talk? Yes, we want to sit and talk. We don't want this to go forever to what's going on in Bahrain. But again, I mean, socially, we don't have a problem, and not before and not now. I believe personally it is a created a problem, but if people like you thinking this way and I would think this way, I think yeah, we can sit and talk and we get over it, because we all want the best to Bahrain as Bahrainis.
Then thank you very much for coming here, sharing your early part of morning with us, hearing about Bahrain. As a Bahraini American, I'm very disappointed in my government stand, the United States stand on Bahrain. I'm hoping and working the best I can to change that, to put democracy and human rights in the forefront. I also salute the people of Bahrain. I mean, I never became as proud as I am now to be Bahraini, my mother country. I've seen people basically have no fear facing brutality and facing oppression, and that only give me more energy to continue advocacy, to continue knocking congressional doors, the State Department, going to different places, building coalition with different NGOs, trying to raise this issue that stable Bahrain is good for us. Bahrain that is full of human rights violations, full of protests, full of government officials denying political problem is not a Bahrain that we need. Stable Bahrain is good for the United States, and that's hopefully what I will continue working for.
I think I'll just reiterate what I've been saying all morning. I'm sure you're sick and tired of hearing it, but it's all about the human rights violations. That's what needs to stop. That's what needs to be dealt with so we can move forward. I think that change will come to Bahrain, whether it comes in a year or whether it comes in 10 years or 15 years. It will come, but it's going to be through one of two ways. It's either going to come after a very, very bloody mess where a lot more people will lose lives, a lot more people will be tortured, and a lot more people will be imprisoned, and through mass protests, or it's going to come through international pressure, which is going to take a lot less time, and it's going to be a lot less bloody. We just have to convince people on the outside that it's not in their interest to support authoritarian regimes who commit human rights violations. And at the end of the day, I think I'll reiterate also what I said yesterday in my interview, which was first, human rights violations need to stop. Then we get reconciliation and justice, because people need to feel that they were given justice. There needs to be accountability, which is something we haven't seen yet. And then we need to come to a situation where the people choose their government, not the government choose their people. I think that's the situation that we need to come to, where we can then say, yes, we're in a situation now where we can move forward. Thank you.
Please, everyone, thank you again for coming. Join me in thanking our panelists for what was a very thoughtful and inspiring. Thank you very much.